Good afternoon. Today, I'm pleased to introduce you to Professor Ruslan Mitkov. Prof. Mitkov is one of the most important natural language processing researchers in the world because of his extensive contributions to different NLP tasks, such as machine translation and anaphora resolution. Likewise, he's the editor of the Natural Language Engineering Journal and of one of the reference books in the area of NLP, the Oxford Handbook of Computational Linguistics. Prof. Mitkov is the head of the research group in computational linguistics at the University of Wolverhampton and the director of the Research Institute in Information and Language Processing. Last, Prof. Mitkov was critically kind to supervise me during my research stay at the University of Wolverhampton. So, Prof. Mitkov, thanks again for accepting our invitation, and you can start when you want.
Thank you very much. I'm going to share my sound. There is, as part of the presentation, there is sound. So I'm just mentioning this just in case your volume is very, very high. So this is the title of my talk. And I'll be speaking of how natural language processing can help can make things easier in life. So this is why the title is with a little help from my friends, actually not from my friends. From my friends is a very well-known song by Beatles. This is with a little help from natural language processing. So my vision has always been that research should actually be to the benefit of society. I have always wanted to produce research which would help people and which will make... can you hear me well?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, so my idea has been always to develop things which make things better for people. So this is the structure of the presentation. I'm going to speak about three applications which help other professionals like translators and languages and university lecturers and teachers, or professionals like translators and interpreters. And then I'm going to outline a project that I had about helping people with language disability in more specifically anaphora. And since you are mostly from the computer science world and work a lot of deep learning, I'm going to say a few words about deep learning. And then I'm going to try to predict the future as to how is the future of natural language processing. So the first task is the generation of multiple choice tests. So what is a multiple choice test? It's you all know what it is, but just to say it once again, it's an efficient, effective way to measure the students' progress. And also you can use it either for testing students or to assess them or to give them the opportunity to exercise. So this is a very time-consuming language and time-consuming and labor-intensive task. We have tried to interview different people who do multiple choice tests, like the BBC and ITV have a lot of shows based on multiple choice tests, and they told us that on a good day, a very good test developer does 5 or 6. What I wanted to do was to develop an alternative methodology to help to speed up the process of generating multiple choice tests. So what is a multiple choice test? This is simply an example. A question, which is the third largest city in Italy? And you can choose whether it's Florence, Naples, or Genoa. So one of them is the correct answer, in this case, Naples. The other ones are called distractors. The first time we developed this methodology was 2003. We developed a system which uses natural language processing, such as parsing, term extraction, question generation, semantic similarity computing. And we use resources like Wikipedia and Corpora and the World Wide Web in general. So the premises was that the question should focus on key concepts. So each time we have a sentence from a manual, we identify the key concept. And then what is very important is to generate distractors which are semantically close to the correct answer, so that those who don't know what the correct answer is shouldn't be able to guess. An example, this is a text, a sentence from a linguistics textbook. Syntax studies the way words are put together into sentences. On this occasion, syntax is identified as an important concept. And you can see here that the question generated is not syntax, but branch of linguistics. So our system then would go into WordNet and see that syntax is a branch of linguistics. And then the correct answer is syntax, but pragmatics, morphology, and semantics are selected as distractors on the basis of the fact that they're semantically very close. Of course, random generation wouldn't help, because if you generate chemistry, for instance, or sport, or football, or beer, everybody will be able to guess that those are not, cannot be correct answers. So this was the methodology I developed about 20 years ago. And I'll tell you a little bit more about this project. So we have term extraction, then question generation. The distractors, the selection of semantically closed distractors is a very important job. So we actually identified nouns and noun phrases using parsers. And then this example shows on the basis of regular expressions that if you have a phrase and the head of a noun phrase, the correct answer, then anything which has the same head could be a distractor. And terms are anchors for generating questions. So the eligible sentences in our first implementation were sentences which have the structure of subject, verb, object, or subject, verb. We had generation rules and also transformational grammar rules to generate sentences, and also Grimman rules and genre-specific heuristics. So semantic closeness, I mentioned this was a very important technique where we could choose the plausible distractors. We use WordNet initially, but if basically too many items, possible candidates are returned from WordNet, we would search in the corpus and then we would choose candidates with the same noun phrase head. This example shows that if we have modifier in the head, everything in the corpus which has modifiers ahead could be eligible distractor. Also, phonetic similarity would be another heuristic that we would use. This is a system in operation. We used the question mark perceptron as an interface, and this is the real question generated. What we did was develop several versions of the system. The first version had three distractors generated, and then were postulated by humans. In the current version of the system, we have a long list of distractors offered to the user, and they have to choose three of them. So this is the interface where you have this. I apologize for going very fast here. I'm going to go to the slide that I simply skipped. So this slide, you can see that this is an answer. Possible distractors, and then the user, those are the ones generated, the user chooses the ones that they think is the best one. So the post-editing is a very important task, just like in machine translation, we had post-editing here. And one thing that you shouldn't worry about, so when we generate automatically multiple choice tests, about 57% of them only were worthy. We had to discard 43%, and only 9% of those that were automatically generated did not need any revision. So basically 91% out of 57% had to be revised, and we had three revisions possible, minor, fair, and major. So this looks like a big job, but before we jump to conclusions, let's see what the results of the experiment show. We experimented with the system by offering it to different systems, to different students at different universities. And the evaluation, we wanted to see two things. First of all, how much time we could save by using this procedure, because developing manually a multiple choice test wouldn't be a very efficient task. It takes a lot of time. And then we wanted to make sure that the quality of the test generated is still very good, because it wouldn't make sense. It wouldn't make sense for you to generate fast items if the quality is very poor. So in terms of efficiency, I'm going to ask you to look at this column. This is the average time per item. to write a multiple choice test item. So we had two students studying linguistics who would write 65 test items in 450 minutes. So it took them almost 7 minutes to do it. So using the system, with the first version of the system, it took them on the average 1 minute and 48 seconds, which means almost four times faster. And then we had to evaluate the quality of the test items, and the quality cannot be very poor, even if you save time. So we used metrics from the classical test theory, like discriminating power. This is a metric which discriminates good students from bad students. Item difficulty: an item shouldn't be too difficult, because if the question is too difficult, nobody will be able to answer it. And if it's too easy, everybody will answer it. So we used other metrics like usefulness of distractors. I'm not going to go into details of the classical test theory. I simply am inviting you to look at this last, the number in this last column, which is an somehow summarized, global summarized score for the quality of the test item. So you can see that in the case of manual, this value is 1.8. So using the system, the old version, the first version of the system, this number goes to 1.92. And using the latest version of the system, it goes to 2.94. So on the basis of those experiments, it looks as if the systems which were written with the help of the system, in other words, automatically generated by the system and then post-edited by human users, had better quality. However, I don't want to generalize those results, because it could be that if you do another experiment, the result may differ a little bit. So in other words, I would like to go for a moderate view, for something which is not so extreme in terms of claims. I'm going to say first that the generation of multiple choice, construction of multiple choice test questions with the help of the system is much more efficient than manual construction. We've seen this is almost four times faster. And then instead of showing off and saying, look, our items produced with the system are much better quality, I'm going to make a very modest claim here that quality is not compromised. Let me limit myself to this. But even if I say this only, this means that this type of semi-automatic generation does save time and is very efficient if you're a teacher, if you're an instructor, in order to produce semi-automatically multiple choice tests. Our latest research on this topic, if you remember, what we did was we looked at sentences, we identified the important concepts, and then those concepts with terms which serve as anchors, and then we will generate questions on the basis of those. So we have one sentence, one question, one sentence, one question. So my idea was to go further, and I said, okay, let's have a look at several sentences, paragraph, or even longer than paragraph, and let's see whether we could generate one question on the basis of the information, not of one sentence, but several sentences. This is a very non-trivial, in fact, very challenging task, because how do you know what the whole paragraph is about? So we decided to use deep learning techniques. We used Dr. Vec and SBIRD for this experiment. And what my idea was to actually to cast this task by as if it was translation memory fuzzy matching. So basically we decided to operationalize multiple choice test items or a corpus as a source text and build also a larger reference corpus, which could be regarded as translation memory system. And then this reference corpus was a collection of many texts on the domain. So we used sentence encoders to improve matching and retrieving the process in translation memory systems. And I'm going to speak about translation memory systems in a few minutes. So using translation, using deep learning, we wanted to see how far we can go. And so deep learning, but basically we cast the task as a translation memory retrieval. This is what we did. And we chose the domain of ECLO because there were many texts on ECLO. And then basically we compiled the corpus of multiple choice questions consisting of triples, paragraph from a chosen book on which the question is based, and the question associated with the paragraph, and the answer. The referent corpus was an EC law book. So it worked. I'm not going to go into many details, but we evaluated the methodology and we found that Doc2Vec wasn't that good to find similar paragraphs, but on the other hand, SBERT, sentence BERT, was very good. And as we know, BERT is a very popular deep learning algorithm model, which we've been using extensively in recent years. So using a translation memory methodology is a feasible method for generating questions. And here is the evaluation. You can see that a similarity score for Doc2Vec is not very good, but for SBERT is quite good, the highest score being 0.86. So what we want to go from there in terms of generation of multiple choice tests, I have shown you how we generate questions from multiple sentences. My next task is to generate questions from multiple documents. Imagine you have not only several sentences, but several documents. So now comes even the more challenging task to identify what those documents are talking about, to identify the different concepts. You choose one or several concepts and then find all the sentences in those documents that talk about this particular concept and then generate a question. This is a difficult task. This is a tall order. So this is something that we want to tackle in the future. So I want to say a few words about this project. When I gave this presentation at the ASL conference in Canada in 2003, and went back to the UK 2 days after that, I was contacted by the head of research of the National Board of Medical Examiners in the United States. This is an organization which actually in the States, if you study 8 years of medicine, you still don't get your license. You have to go through a series of tests in order to be licensed to be a doctor. So this organization contacted me and I said, look, I want to come take the plane and come and speak to you. They came to Wolverhampton, we started speaking, and they have been funding us for the last 17 years. They use our tools for the low stake medical assessment test that they use on a daily basis. So our tools and programs are used in the United States for to be doctors. This is something I'm really proud of. So they could have gone to any of the top United States NLP groups. And we know that USA, United States of America, are probably the leading country in the world in terms of natural language processing, but they continue and prefer to work with us, not with their top groups. Then the second part, we'll talk about translation memory systems, what we have done to improve them. Before I speak about translation memory systems, I'll give you a little bit of background. So machine translation came out 70 years ago. Basically, it is working now better. It provides billion translators, translations for more than 200 million users a day. It surpasses what professional translators can handle in 1 year. And machine translation has taken off really after statistical and neural machine translation. But what is happening? Okay, Google Translate has outperformed Systron and Prompt due to the availability of huge bilingual data. And machine translation works also in combination with translation memory systems like MateCut and MemoQ. It is used even by professional translators nowadays. Many professional translator agencies use machine translation to run the text and then post-edit it. By doing so, they save a lot of time. However, his dream, Weaver was the one who proposed the machine translation application in 47. I'm going to talk about this in a few minutes. But still, machine translation wasn't good. Even today, I wanted to show you an example how machine translation operates on the so-called multi-word expressions, which are sequences of words which don't have the same meaning. So in this sentence, English sentence, kick the bucket is a multi-word expression. It means to die. But unless you know what it means, you wouldn't be able to translate it. So I did a few very simple experiments, first with a system called Prompt, developed in St. Petersburg which was very famous 20 years ago. In 2015, I tried to use this to translate into Spanish, and you can see the translation into Spanish, very poor indeed. Then I used Sistran, which is used on a daily basis in the European community. The translation into Spanish is equally poor. Then I used Google Translate, and you can see that Google Translate is slightly better, but still not very good. The verb estirar is not conjugated. I repeated those experiments in 2018 when we had neural machine translation powered by deep learning. The same systems, I'm not going to focus on those slides a lot, but you can see the same poor translation by prompt, by Sistran, and also by Google Translate, equally bad as 2015. It doesn't matter that it was neural machine translation. And here you have the DeepL, the company boasting itself using deep learning to translate, but very poor translation. So, which means that machine translation is still not working in a way which is impeccable. Going back to the 70s, there was, because machine translation then was even poorer, there was a very strong need to develop tools to help translators. They did not believe at that time machine translation. Now they believe it more and more. But they wanted other tools, the so-called translation memory tools. So the idea was to reuse existing human translation. So imagine you translate and translate and translate, and you keep a database of translation. So each time you translate a new sentence, your system, your program compares the current sentence against the database. And this is called fuzzy match. And then those tools were commercialized by companies like Trados and Star Transit. And this is how it all started. They revolutionized the work of translators. The translation memory tools reused ideas from previous translations. They made it possible for a translator not to translate the same material twice. And as Pierre Isabel from Montreal said, existing translations contain more solution to more translation problems than any other available resource. This is a simple example of how translation memory works. Imagine you have to translate this sentence from English into German. And imagine that in your database of translations, in the so-called translation memory, you have translated a similar sentence from English into German. So what is the similarity between those two sentences? Well, it's almost the same. You have only different verbs here and different nouns here. So the fuzzy match based on Levenstein distance was 82%. So basically, no, 84 in fact. So all you have to do is simply find a translation of creating an actions into German, and it takes 2 seconds to translate this sentence. So they were mainly for professional translators, those systems, and they were very good for consistency of terms and for repetitive texts. In other words, medical texts, legal texts, technical texts, very good for large amounts of text. Those are the most popular translation memory systems. However, the commercial translation memory systems, even though sell well, even if you're a translator, you know that you cannot actually earn your bread if you don't use translation memory system, because the main business is not literary translation. The main business is technical translation, medical translation, legal translation. So those commercial systems have a lot of limitations. If you look at those three sentences, the wild child is destroying his new toy, the wild chief is destroying his new tool, and the wild children are destroying their new toy. If I ask you which are the most two similar ones, you're going to say 1 and 3, which is correct. But for a translation memory system, they'll say that 1 and 2 are more similar. Why? Because they use the Levenstein distance, which is based on computing how many insertions or swaps of characters in a string are available. So they would say that looking at this string similarity, those two strings are more similar. Fair enough, but it is not what the meaning of the sentences represent. So can you hear the sound?
Yes, we can hear it.
Thank you. Well, I said some of my slides will have sound. And this is one of the slides which has sound. A little bit of music from the Carpenters. We have just begun. This is because this is when it started. In 2005, I proposed for the first time to develop new generation translation memory systems, which would actually take into consideration not only the string similarity, but also the semantic similarity. So I wanted to develop machine translation memory systems which look at the semantic similarity, not syntactic similarity, between sentences. In fact, we have done many studies which show that if you start to reorder a sentence, it doesn't change in terms of meaning, because you can reorder the sentence, you can use synonyms. Basically, the transformation will basically keep the same meaning, but the thing is the translation memory systems really fail. They fail and they return very poor match. So if you change the active voice to passive voice, the same meaning, but they fail. If you change the word order, they fail. If you change one word with a synonym, they fail. So in other words, those translation memory systems, the commercial ones, which are still on sale, don't do very well. So what my group has done, me and members of my group, we have actually developed translation memory systems which take into consideration the meaning. This is something which has been done for the first time, and we are very pleased that we can basically report such a new generation of translation memory systems. So how does it work? Let me just give an example. This was an example of a talk which I gave in Brazil. So imagine you have this sentence, I like Rio de Janeiro, which is such an attractive and exciting place. And another sentence, I love Rio de Janeiro, as the city is full of attraction and excitement. And then you have a sentence which has a completely different meaning. So if you run a normal commercial translation memory systems, they use edit distance, which is like Levenstein distance from 0 to 100. The higher the number, the higher the similarity. We developed a semantic textual similarity measure, which is between 1 and 5. So here, those two sentences have 72 Levenstein distance and 3 semantic similarity. And those two sentences, which are completely different in meaning, give a very high score using the commercial translation memory system for the matching algorithm. And our algorithm, of course, shows that they're not similar at all. So this is a summary. You can see that we're moving in the right direction. And this, in our latest paper on this is about using sentence encoders to compute semantic similarity between sentences. And I'll tell you something, when the first time we started using parsers in 2007, it took about 1 or 2 hours to compute the semantic similarity between two sentences. Now it takes a second using deep learning techniques. So we're moving in the right directions. And I'm going to say a few words about interpreters, because I've been speaking about translators, and the interpreters are a little bit forgotten. They don't have many tools, but there has been recent interest in developing tools for interpreters, and this is one of the areas I have been working on. So you can assist the interpreters in two different jobs, either in the preparation of the job or during the interpreting job. The second one is more tricky. Why? Because interpreting is a very, requires a serious cognitive effort, and some interpreters are not very good at multitasking. They don't want to be disturbed during interpreting. So they prefer to do something during the preparation of the work. So what we have done what we're planning to do partly is we automatically translate new emerging terms. You cannot find their translators into dictionaries, because dictionaries do not keep up with the new terms. The terms actually develop much faster. They come on much faster. You cannot find them in dictionaries. The other thing that we have done, we use comparable copper to extract the translations, but One thing that we want to do, and we're working on it, to if an interpreter wants to interpret in a specific domain, they don't need to use hours to or days to basically read about this domain. What we want to do is automatically generate a survey of the domain using natural language processing techniques such as coreference resolution, summarization, and others. So this is another thing. I'm going to say about an idea that I had, and I pass it on to one of my students, and I'll show you what the system would do. So interpreters, they have all say that they would benefit if on the screen they have names, dates, numbers, and even multi-word expressions, because they cannot remember so many names when somebody speaks. But the automatic identification of names, name entity recognition, so dates or numbers, is not always so easy. So using natural language processing techniques, this can be done. And this is simply an illustration. Imagine that somebody is speaking this, and this is on the screen using speech to text. And then the next thing your tool needs to do is to identify the multi-word expressions and names like Prince William of Wales, United Kingdom, Duchess of Cambridge, different names, dates, numbers, and then automatically using extraction and translation, automatic translation from English into Spanish, have those terms on the screen, and then simply reading them out. I have a student whom I'm supervising who completed his dissertation on this topic, and he has even a demo on this. And the next thing we want to do, of course, is translation, interpreting memory for interpreters, but this is a more difficult task in terms of engineering implementation. So I have mentioned that I have always wanted to help people in need. This is my main philosophy. This is my mission and research. So we have here Eugenio, who is the convener of the seminar. He was then working in Jaén, and Jaén was one of the members of our consortium. The project that I coordinated was called FIRST. It was about developing tools to simplify text and make text more easier to read for people with autism. And people suffering from autism are really, it's a very sad story. This is a book from Hape from 95. It gives a different examples of people with autism. So this is, if you say to a child who has autism, stick your coat down over there, and this child is looking for a ghoul. This is a sad story because she understands stick your coat down as something literal. Or if you ask her to give you a hand, she will say that she needs the hand to keep, she needs to keep both hands. Obviously, she doesn't understand that this is a multi-word expression. This is a not literal meaning, give you a hand. And another sad story, you tell a little boy that his sister is crying her eyes out. He understands this literally, that the ice balls are on the floor. So I'm very passionate about helping people who are in need, and I'm very passionate about helping people with language disabilities. So we delivered this tool. The idea was to reduce complexity, remove ambiguity, and improve readability. I'm going to offer you a video.
This is Al. He has autism, a lifelong condition of the brain that affects his ability to understand things, communicate with others, and interact socially. Autism makes it difficult for Al to understand written information and communications. This can be a real barrier to doing important things, like getting a job, or understanding the news, or administrative documents. That's why we have produced a new tool to adapt text and documents into a form that is easier for people with autism to read and understand. OpenBook takes an original text and adapts it, removing many of the obstacles that prevent a person with autism from understanding it. The text can be formatted to make it easier to read and magnified so that the user can concentrate on one sentence at a time. Users can get an explanation of words and expressions that are long or unfamiliar, and view images that can increase understanding of the words and concepts in the text. Also, complex sentences can be reduced to shorter, simpler sentences. No two individuals who have autism experience exactly the same difficulties. For instance, Anna is able to read fluently. On the other hand, Peter is not able to read at all. Al, however, can read, but he has difficulties. Open Book is an excellent solution for him because to account for differences in individual reading abilities, the settings of Open Book can be personalized, enabling Al to adapt documents to match his own abilities and needs. As some people with autism need more assistance with reading than others, Open Book also provides an interface for carers. When Al doesn't understand something, he can call on a parent or carer for help. And carers can respond. They can replace difficult and uncommon words with simpler ones. And also add pictures and definitions. And links to more information. The Open Book tool is being produced in English, Spanish, and Bulgarian by the FIRST project, a collaborative research project bringing together experts in the fields of language technology, software development, and autism from across Europe. The team worked with a large group of people who have autism in the United Kingdom, Spain, and Bulgaria to ensure that Open Book is designed and tested to meet their needs. This is one of the
Actually, I pressed something which stopped the video, but this was the end of the video, in fact. So you saw that the University of Caen was represented. So I have to share the screen once again. Can I ask you whether you could hear the sounds?
Yes, Rustam. We listened all the sounds on all the video, on the entire video.
Well, I hope you were able to kill the sound. So the presentation hasn't finished yet. So I wanted to say something about deep learning because I know that all of you work in the field of deep learning. So, and I'm going to say what, in my view, will happen in the future. Can you hear any sound here or cannot?
Now, yes.
Oh. Okay, sorry, I don't know what happened. I pressed something I shouldn't have. Now you can hear, right? Yes, and I was just saying that the presentation hasn't finished. I have another 5 minutes. So I'm going to say a few words about deep learning and about what is going to happen in the future. So can you hear any sound?
Now it's pity, but now we don't listen to any sound.
I don't know why the sound is not. It's okay. Basically, it was a song by Janet Brown called "It's a Man's Man's World," and I was going to say that today is by far not a man's man's world, but today is a deep learning world, and deep learning holds a very serious promise. We use deep learning everywhere, and those are a few projects where we use deep learning, and I see one of my students, Damit, attending. He's an expert in deep learning. So we use machine deep learning for predicting the quality of machine translation. I mean, my group, and more specifically Terindo, developed the best machine translation quality predicting tool in the world. Today, we had more than 20,000 downloads already, and we had the highest score. We use deep learning for translation memory systems. I mentioned some. We use it for detecting figurative language, for distinguishing fake news from real news. I'm going to have a student who will work on predicting the success of a new film. And I have a student whom I named Damit. He works in the law domain. He identifies court cases of unethical behavior using deep learning. And we have another project starting where we want to simplify educational text in history so that children can understand them better. So we use different deep learning models. For instance, for semantic textual similarity, we use a Siamese neural network for language detection. We use, for offensive language detection, we use LSTM and GRU. For TransQuest, this is the translation quality estimation, we use cross-lingual transformers. Sentence decoder encoders are used for intelligent translation memory system matching and different models of transformers for all kind of tasks, including transformers, including definition extraction, question answering in low resource domain, and detection of multi-word expressions in flower and plant names. And Damit is also involved in this project, as is Terindo and Amal, who is attending. So I wanted to say a few things about the future of natural language processing. So, I mean, this is something that is difficult to predict. If I was able to predict things, I'll be able to be a millionaire. This was a song, a hit from a long time ago by a duo called Zagre and Evans, and they predicted the future like this. In their song, they want to predict what is going to happen in 2025. They basically did not mention computers at all. They didn't mention artificial intelligence at all. So they couldn't predict. So I can probably predict slightly better than them in terms of natural language processing because I've been working for many years in the field. But first of all, I'm going to define something which is called linguistic intelligence. This is the ability of a human being to express himself or herself intelligently. So whether computers can express themselves as intelligently as humans. So regarding human intelligence, my question is, of course, this is a difficult one, is if you look at people like Shakespeare, Goethe, Cervantes, Dante Alighieri, Alexander Pushkin, is whether we have the same people of the same caliber who can write equally well as then. Of course, I'm not going to engage in these discussions. Some people may say no, some people may say yes, but this is actually the so-called computational intelligence, the ability of computers to understand languages and express themselves in languages. So here we have nothing because there are no computers. Here this grows. So now we're in 2022. So this computational intelligence is somewhere here. So the blue line is the human intelligence. So how well humans write, how well humans understand. So my question is, what's going to happen in, let's say, in 2100? What is going to happen in 2200? I mean, this is a very good question. And of course, I can only say what I think, not necessarily I'll be correct. So all of you are experts in artificial intelligence, in computing. I'm not going to embark on a historical lesson of historical computing, but the first computer, if you read German sources, they'll say that the first computer was proposed by Zuse in Germany in 43. If you read British sources, they'll say that the first one was developed in Bletchley near Cambridge, which cracked the German code. If you read American ones, they'll say that the first one was developed in Pennsylvania in 46 called ENIAC. So let's agree that the first computer was developed somewhere in Germany, United Kingdom, and USA between 43 and 46, because it was 43, 46. So we're going to see what's going to happen in 1 year later than that. So this is what we assume. So only 1 year after that, in 47, we have Weaver. Who was an American statistician and mathematician who said that machine translation is a very easy task. He said, all you need to do is to encode a source text and decode it into a target text. Obviously, this is what he thought was going to do. And he thought it was very easy. So, and this is why there were so many jokes about poor machine translation. In fact, there was a joke saying that there was a system translating from English into Russian. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. This is a biblical sentence. Then back from Russian into English, and then the translation will be, the vodka is strong, but the meat is rotten. I mean, this is simply a made-up example, but which comes to show how poor machine translation was. So at that time, computers were slow and unreliable. There were no programming languages. We're talking about 47. How can you develop a program if you don't have any programming languages? Even assembler wasn't available then. There was no adequate theory of language. So those people working in the 40s and the 50s really had a real tough time. And Chomsky's generative grammar came out in 56. So he would have failed, even if he had the supercomputers of today. His view is very simplistic, and language is irregular and ambiguous. So this is something I'm going to say. So language is much more complicated and complex than mathematics. This is why you cannot somehow do it in such a way like artificial intelligence. Natural languages are really a murder for computers. I mean, with the advent of machine learning, deep learning, and using deep learning in a translation, there were all kind of announcements in the press saying that machine translation has achieved human parity, but this was not true, of course. And this was a myth. Machine translation hasn't achieved human parity. And the examples I gave you a few minutes ago when translating this multi-word expression, kick the bucket, show that machine translation is far from perfect. And how can machine translation cope, or natural language processing cope with situations like pragmatics, figurative language, emotional intelligence, translating literature and philosophy? Those are very difficult tasks for a computer program. I mean, to show how complicated language is, I want you to read this sentence. This is a sentence which I gave in my book, Good Enough for Resolution. If Peter Mandelson had been in Tony Blair's shoes, he would have demanded his resignation the day the prime minister forced him to leave the cabinet. So what is he? What is his? What is him? Neither of them. So, I mean, Tony Blair is neither of them, nor is Peter Mandelson. So this is a very difficult example, even for humans. In fact, he is an imaginary character, Peter Mandelson, in Tony Blair's role. So this is an example which shows that humans have difficulties, let alone computers. So I wish I was a clairvoyant, but I'm not. And people do ask me to predict the future of natural language processing. I'm not a clairvoyant, but on the basis of what I see, this blue line, this is the human intelligence, will be never crossed by the red line, which is the computational intelligence. So I believe that even in 2200, the computational intelligence, the artificial intelligence in terms of understanding and writing languages, is not going to reach the human one. So this is my prediction. Whether I'm correct or not, I'm not going to know, because I won't be alive in 2200. So my idea has always been for computers and humans not to compete, but for computers to help humans. Computers are not very good at certain things, but they're very good at routine jobs. And this is what we should explore. So this talk was about different natural language processing applications, how they could help humans. And this is why I called it With a Little Help from Natural Language Processing.
What would you think if I sang out a tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends. Gonna try with a little help from my friends.
Thank you very much. This was the whole presentation.
Thank you very much, Professor Mitko, for this nice and interesting presentation about how NLP can apply in real use cases. No, because it's important to know also the application view of technology, of science, because sometimes in academia we are extremely focused only on theory, on our papers. And it is important to also to view this part of our that our research can be applied to resolve real problems. So now it's time to make questions. Okay, Professor Mitko will be happy to answer all their doubts, suggestions, and questions. So, okay, so feel free to make any question about any topic related to the talk or whatever or the topic. Maybe I can start with a question. So although I know, Professor Mitko, that you can't figure out the future, okay? But I'm wondering your opinion about the short-term challenges of mass translation. So what could be the next steps in mass translation, okay, in the short term? So the new features that we will be able to see, okay, or to use in every day.
I mean, machine translation has been so successful in recent years, thanks to the use of deep learning technology, in the sense that it's called neural machine translation, that basically, there have been people like Jochen Hummel, who is the chief executive officer of Trados. This was the first translation memory tool. And he's now also chief executive officer of Corel. People like him start to predict that basically translation memory systems will start to disappear. So translators will stop using translation memory systems, but they'll be using machine translation and they'll be post-editing. So I believe what has been happening in the last 2-3 years and what will happen in the near future would be, because deep learning models take, as every day you have new ones. So I think what the people will do two things: to experiment with latest deep learning models, and then they'll be using more and more data, because even in the field of neural machine translation and deep learning, when you have quality data annotated and the program being able to learn from your data, the quality will improve. So my actually prediction is that in the next few years, we'll have more and more actually employment of latest neural deep learning techniques aligned and coupled with the production of larger data, so that the system can learn from data. Even though in deep learning, as you know, data is crucial. Some models work on less data, some others on more, but the more data we have, the better. So this is my prediction. The more data and the latest models will deliver better results.
So thanks, Ruslan. Okay, now, okay. Nuria Rodriguez, that is now working with Jose Camacho in Cardiff. She writes on two questions in the chat because she can't use her microphone. So she asked, which of the automatic translators or massive translator systems on the market do you think is the best? Which one do you think is the most promising because of the approach they try?
Well, all experiments that we have been doing and people have been doing show that there are two systems that outperform the rest. Those are Google Translate and DeepL. And obviously, it's also interesting what comparison you make. So for instance, I mean, to say that one system is always better, it's almost impossible because some of the systems will do better on one feature, some others on another. For instance, if you, I'm going to give again the example of multi-word expressions. So on multi-word expressions, it appears the DeepL does slightly better, but on many other tasks, Google Translate does better. So everybody would agree that from those systems that exist, the ones that are most popular and mostly used are DeepL and Google Translate.
So thanks, Ruslan. So any more questions? So feel free to open your microphone and to make questions or to write on the chat. So go ahead, Natalia.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for the presentation. I wonder in the approach where you give explanation for the autism kids, like it would be nice, I guess, to automate the process. I guess at the end you would like to automate this process that are responses from humans and maybe fact checking explanations from the explainability point of view in which I'm working. I see this as it would be a nice way to explain question answering models, right? So how do you see the, can we merge somehow? Do you see some models that are promising or techniques to blend the human explanation of why these facts means this exactly, and maybe models that do automatic fact checking and point you at specific tasks in the specific, let's say, sentences in the text in the text to answer a given question? Like, what about when the model contradicts the expert explanation? I mean, I'm very interested in blending the human expert explanation and the machine explanation.
I mean, we have had projects on question answering. In fact, we had the so-called Call Me project where we developed a question answering system back in 2003. We didn't commercialize it. And of course, Apple came with Siri 2 years after them, and they developed the first question answering system. So you're saying about blending question answering with what application?
I was just thinking of the application you show of explaining things to autism people.
I mean this actually application, the one that I showed you. I hope the sound was okay. Basically, we would take a text and simply simplify it. We wouldn't actually do anything else. We would either simplify it or present it in a more accessible form to the user. So in this particular one, we didn't have actually any additional explanation. So we simply had simplifying the only thing which we had was providing additional information about certain terms which were not clear. We would actually generate a link to an encyclopedic database. So this is what we would do. But I think you're talking about something else. You just proposing something else here. Could you say what you're proposing?
I was thinking, in your example, you have experts giving the explanation, right? You have humans. So wouldn't it be interesting to have a machine learning from these human answers to train a model that explains or simplifies this? So once we would have that, maybe it's just an example, but I'm just wondering if this could be blended with other tasks, other machine learning tasks like text summarization that also summarizes text So it would be a similar application, but maybe at the paragraph level instead of a sentence level, in which we could combine both the machine output with the human output. And how?
Yes, I mean, obviously what you're suggesting is a very interesting one, is to have an application which learns from human explanations, and then being able also to somehow to revise the text and to include a summary of it. Of course, we have here the complexity of text generation task, where you can generate text, whether they're explanation, whether they're summaries, but obviously the long have gone the days where we try to do everything using linguistic rule-based approaches. Now we're talking about using what you're suggesting, using machine learning, learning from data, from explanations given by humans, right? I think this will be a very interesting application. I mean, is this what you're working on yourself?
Somehow, yes, but I'm now focused on images. So, but of course, the next step is to generalize to all kind of data and tasks. So, but yeah, how multimodality helps providing explanations and to also reinforce the model to revise it, as you very well said, to improve the model eventually.
I mean, in this particular project, I mean, obviously this project finished about 6 years ago. We had also multimodal references because we made it easier for the learner to see pictures, to see images, yes.
Okay. Thanks. I guess it's a lot of future work to do.
Thanks a lot, Natalia. Any more questions? So I can finish with a last question, Rustam, okay, related also to a little bit with the future. So it's regarding this movement in NLP, that is the NLP based on great amount of data. So my view in the last time is that we only get further, okay, with more data. And I see like the field is a little bit stuck in the same, okay, we are kind of a stop in the same, okay, we only see that the people improve the models with more and more data, okay. What do you think, okay, that the field should go or should research or should study in order to go a step further, to get again to the main problems of NLP, what are okay to discover the meaning, okay, the real meaning, to the disambiguation, to the and to go to these levels of semantic level, pragmatic level, in order to complete the understanding part of NLP. So what do you think that we should put our time, put our effort, in order to try to discover new solutions to the main problems of NLP? So because now, okay, I only see that in the last paper that, okay, people, all people resolve the problem with fine tuning, more data, more data, more data. So do you think, okay, we are forgetting something? Okay, we are not looking for some features, some knowledge, okay. So what do you think? Okay, how is the field of NLP now, the current situation?
Okay. Okay, I'm going to reply to the question of the data first, and then I'm going to say something about the understanding in NLP. So it's interesting that you have this question, because I recently did a study, not recently, it was 2 years ago, because everybody is crazy about data. They say the more data, the better, the more data, the better. This could be true in general, but I wanted to see whether the quality of data plays also a role. So I did a study with a former PhD student of mine. Now she works in Cambridge, Shiva. We looked at the task of automatic translation and extraction of multi-word expressions between English and Spanish. And we looked at several scenarios. And we, because we use comparable corpora, we actually came to the conclusion that only a large amount of data is not sufficient. In order for your system to have a good performance, you need to have a minimum quality. So as long as the quality of the data is of minimal, minimum threshold, the minimum score, then basically you won't get further. So the conclusion was that only data, only quantity of data is not sufficient. You need a quality data. So this is the first thing that I wanted to mention, because this study hasn't been done before. We did, I did it for the first time on this particular task, because people always say data, 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 but data, data, data is not sufficient unless it is of minimal quality. And then in regard to your second question, understanding. So if you go back to the traditional NLP methods, I'm going to take the task of an alpha resolution because I have worked for many years on this task. So the improvement has been minimal over the years. So you need about 10 years to get 3-4% improvement. So this is a very difficult task in the future. I mean, we were inspired by the results in deep learning. I mean, in order to have better results in natural language processing without data in deep learning, we need to have better parsers, we need to have better processing tools, we need to have also better natural language processing models in general. And this is something that will take very long. I mean, I'm sorry that I'm a bit pessimistic about this, but the improvements will go for many years. So in my judgment is that there will be improvements in the traditional way we look at NLP, but they'll be very incremental. The non-incremental improvements can happen through data in deep learning. This is my personal conclusion.
So we have to keep hard working in order to continue progressing in NLP. So if there is no more questions, okay, I think it's time to thanks again to Professor Mitkov to this fantastic talk that we have the place to listen, to learn. So thank you very much, Professor Mitkov, and I hope I'm looking forward to take another cup of coffee with you and to continue speaking about NLP and about the life. And thanks again.
Yes, I'm planning actually to come to Granada soon. I don't know whether it will be next month or the month after, but I hope to see you and have a coffee with you.
Yeah, please let me know. Thanks, Professor. So bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you very much, all.